today, yeah, we're just gonna focus in on try to get through four books that I designed while I was at the Aspen Art Museum. And so yeah, I'll share my screen and slowly kind of walk through what those book projects are. But first I wanna kind of give a really quick kind of primer on just like my general approach for book design that you'll see sort of like underskirting much of the conversation to kind of come ahead. And the primary sort of mode or the primary sort of objective of an exhibition catalog is to not only just show the artist's work, but for me, it's to sort of translate the qualities of the artist's work into book form and to sort of try to elevate it within that context and within that platform. So today I'm going to talk about four different ideas of translation, and throughout the entire talk, all of these modes of translation and ideas of translation sort of like bleed and flow within each project. But I think the different books will highlight these ideas of translation more clearly. And so the first one that I'm going to talk about is just ideas of practice, translation of experience, translation of material, and translation of process and culture. So yeah, let's just kick it off. And so each of these talks is gonna begin, or each section of the talk is also gonna begin with installation imagery, showing the artworks within the space, because you can't really begin any sort of discussion of an art book without understanding the artworks themselves and what the exhibitions were sort of, you know, what they were visually communicating to visitors within that space. So the first exhibition is Cheryl Donegan's Girls Plus Veils. And this is just some installation imagery. Cheryl Donegan is a particularly interesting artist whose varying different bodies of work sort of flow in and influence each other. So here on this wall, you can see a series of what Cheryl calls gingham paintings. And you can see how the exhibition is wrapping around the corner. I think something to pay attention to here when looking at these imagery, at these images, is how the show is hung. And another series of works, these being called crack paintings. And in addition to the paintings, Cheryl also began producing fashion works. And here you can see within the gallery space, the fashion works situated within the middle of the gallery with the paintings sort of wrapping around. You know, within these photographs, you see the different bodies of work colliding, and you're able to make visual connections and connecting motifs. And that's something that I tried to strive through the book in showing how these different works sort of bleed together. So you can see here a unique dyeing process is used to create these paintings. And then that same process is used to alter and to sort of treat each of the garments differently. Again, you can see the sort of direct correlation, visual correlation and material correlations between the two bodies of work. So this is just to give you a bit of a primer and context of the work. Something that's not shown in the Aspen Art Museum show that is very important and very very important to the history of Cheryl's work, but also to the book, is her video works. And we'll look at a few specific video works when I start discussing the book more directly. But something to sort of pay attention to is also the Kunsthal Zurich was a co-publisher of this catalog. And before the show traveled to the Aspen Art Museum, the show was put on at the Kunsthal Zurich. And here you can see similar modes of presentation, but the sort of missing body of work that isn't shown at Aspen is the video works. And here you can see the same sort of methodology of collapsing and showing the multiple bodies of work within the same space, almost unseparated. So here you see garments, as well as the dye painted banners and then video works. So again, a little bit more context of the work within like physical space, and then how this, how these practices are going to translate into the book. So from the very beginning, we knew through initial conversations with Cheryl that we wanted to feature a gingham painting on the front cover. And we knew that the book was going to be a hardcover. Typically, these are the types of conversations that you have when setting the budget of the book, figuring out the best format, the expectations of the institution and the expectations of the artist. And so we knew that since this was going to be Cheryl's first book, we wanted to encapsulate as much of her work as possible. And, you know, in the worst case scenario, if there was never going to be an institutional monograph or catalog published on Cheryl's work, can this book satisfy that gap within publishing and really do justice to the body of work? So something to pay attention to here is this particular painting. So these gingham paintings are done with acrylic on dyed burlap. And having walked through the gallery with swatches of book cloth, this painting sort of jumped out as a sort of perfect match. And then this became the sort of cover of the book. And through the entire process, this was one of the only things through the design process that never sort of changed and remained fixed. And you can see a direct connection between the edge of the painting here and the tipped on plate on the front. So again, this sort of directly illustrates this idea of translation. So taking inspiration directly from the artist's work and then applying that within the context of the book. Now, something else that that we did, which was really unique and something that, again, without printers and production workers at printers who are like striving to do something new and different wouldn't have been possible. But we shipped cuts of the raw cloth to Cheryl's studio. And then because of the nature of the cloth itself being similar to the material that she uses within her paintings, she was able to apply the same exact process of dye, of the sort of reverse dye sublimation technique that she does, that she uses for her paintings, you know, that can be seen here. So Cheryl was able to create 100 different essentially painted covers that were then shipped back to Belgium to the binder and used in the final production. So here you can see different special covers, and we produced 100 of these, 40 of which evaporated from the planet through shipping, some sort of shipping hazard, lost in sort of translation. But here, you know, you can see different examples of her painting techniques applied directly to the book cover, again, representing another idea of translation. And while I'm sort of discussing all of these books over here, you can sort of see videos of the actual like books themselves being sort of flipped through. So you get a better sense of the material qualities of the books. And again, these are just some selections of those special painted covers. Cool. So again, like the idea of this book was to really encapsulate all three bodies of work. So fashion, painting, and video. And so we have painting sort of represented on the outside of the book. And what we wanted to do then is to really coat the book in fashion. So the end papers and the first title page here are direct scans, full-size scans of details made from the garments themselves. And then those are printed in silver on a special crafted paper by Fed Rigoni that has a really subtle texture to it. And that texture then points back to the canvas materials, but also to the sort of source imagery from which these patterns are sort of taken. And something that you can't necessarily see from these abstracted details and in the garments themselves is the fact that these gestures were made through air conditioner grill graffiti. So the markings of metal grills on air conditioners around New York, Cheryl documented and then translated into a body of works within the paintings, but then in the fashion garments themselves. And again, you could see a better sort of relation of that here. So we have the sort of detail printed in a PMS silver, again, to sort of better match the idea of the air conditioners themselves. And then an installation, a sort of plate view of one of the garments. And then within the book, there are a series of three different foldouts that also help structure and organize the book by body of work and to help highlight each specific body of work. And in this one, you can see that this is the fashion trifold. So we have, a large detail. And then on the inside of that trifold is a swath, a collection or archive of the original source imagery used in the garments. So if we look here, we can see how that mark is directly translated within this detail shot. So a sort of direct correlation from the primary source material and then being treated and dyed within like the fabrics themselves. And sort of when sort of planning the content, because typically as a designer within exhibition catalogs, you operate as an image editor as much as a designer. So being able to sort of suggest and sort of come up with these ideas of helping the viewer have a better understanding of the material, of the artworks, through this sort of juxtaposition of raw material like we have here with the sort of the documented material. And like you do as a designer working with printers and production artists within printers, you also work closely with photographers and planning the shoots and helping to sort of create the best type of imagery to communicate or translate the artworks as best as possible. So coordinating these detail shots, these specific detail shots here, to sort of align with other sections of the book to sort of tell a full story. And then here you can see an example of a typical plate page within the book. So here the primary goal is to just show the artworks, at least in this project particular, to show the artworks as large as possible and to try to reproduce the colors as best as possible. And something that you'll notice in the video is the different paper stocks. You'll actually be able to see them clearly here. And when working on a book, because a book is a physical object of bound pages, the first thing I try to do is think about what is the best paper or the best material to communicate the type of content that's being shown. And that's a sort of a primary question that I ask myself. And that primary question is like, what leads to the choice of paper? Is it to best represent color and best reproduce color on the page? Is it about offering something different and tactile? Is it about showing like drastic difference between content? So here, you can see the trifold that leads into the video section of the book. So on one side, we have Cheryl within the studio, surrounded by monitors. It's a black and white archival image, and this image is reproduced on a recently discontinued paper, unfortunately, that is fully recycled. It has a really beautiful, soft contrast to the sort of blacks. It provides a really good reading experience called Cyclist Offset. And you can see this juxtaposed with the special textured paper used throughout the book called Symbol Free Life. And this special textured paper lends itself more to like to film grain or to the texture seen through CRT monitors. So you can see this sort of juxtaposition between these two paper stocks here. And then this fold showing Polaroid images that Cheryl took of monitors. So throughout the book is archival material is scattered through. And when working directly with an artist within an institution, it really opens up possibilities that otherwise might not be possible. And that is direct access to the archive. And you'll see how that direct access to an archive really becomes beneficial to sort of telling the full story in the last book that I talk about. But here you can see the Polaroids as they were exactly FedExed to us at the Aspen Art Museum. So they were taped up, three up on a sheet of paper. And we just sort of drum scanned those in high resolution. And then use those as a section opener for the video section. And here you can see a sub table of contents. And this table of contents structure details the title of the work, as well as aspects of other qualities like whether or not it's in color or black and white, if there's sound, the pages in which it falls on within the subsection, as well as the duration of the video. So we have a sort of sub table of contents within the book for the video section. And then here you can see an example spread of how the videos are translated within book form, because it's a video in and of itself. And you'll see this once we watch a few clips, you know, it's something that's moving, but the book is a static object. And increasingly more often, the books that I'm working on are addressing these ideas of translating, you know, motion media, video works onto the printed page and, you know, finding the best way to do that, you know, create something interesting and unique, but then also speaks directly to the work. And what we talked about a lot in initial conversations was this hybrid between the art book and then the photo book and then the video work being something that's in motion that has rhythm and pacing to it. So one of the novel ideas that we had was to timestamp each screen grab and clip that's made, and then also using scale of image to sort of connote prominence and importance, but then also using gaps within the grid and using a flexible grid to sort of create an idea of re-editing. And in two recent projects, one for Jonas Mikas and then another for Rashid Johnson, also published by the Aspen Art Museum and Hauser & Wirth Publishers, this idea of a sort of re-editing for the book context, just in the same way that you would you know, translate the entire exhibition experience to the book context is something that, you know, it helps create something new and different. So here you can see a detail of those timestamps and how time is sort of shown through the book. So we have, you know, we have a gap here of a little under 30 seconds between a sort of larger screen grab and then the sort of ending of the film. And we'll just quickly just watch a few seconds of the video work, so you can sort of get a better sense of what the primary material is. Another important aspect about the video works within Cheryl's body of work is this idea of endurance and repetition. And that's something else that we wanted to show by offering up, you know, more than just a single spread for video works, really showing this repetition of movement and the duration and the endurance that the artist is sort of going through within the performance. And then here are other examples of how that grid sort of plays out within the film works. And this grid is loosely adapted and adjusted based on the film works themselves. So here we see the work practice and how the grid and how the films are shown differently compared to the work of Head here.
Well, you know, don't you, Kenneth, or haven't I told you, every telling is a telling, and that's a he and a she is. Look, the dust is growing. My branches lost, you're taking root, and my cold chair is gonna...
See the difference of sort of the video grids.
What age is that? It soon is late. It's endless now since I ran on one last saw water hoses truck. They took it asunder, I heard them say, when they reassembled. Oh, my back. I want to go to Aix les Bains in time.
Cool. Sorry about that. So really sort of adapting and embracing this idea of the photo book or the sort of magazine idea and treating the video works that way in order to create something that, you know, across 120 pages of video works doesn't become sort of, repetition of the same sort of structure. So each content piece is treated differently and really intentionality is present within the screen grabs, right? So here this section of the video is a sort of digital representation of the face paintings that take place within this video work, and really just offering and showing these connections across different works and different bodies of work, and how these motifs really sort of come out. And that's something that you don't necessarily see when you're looking at individual works at once, but the structure of a book can really help provide that through line of motif. Another example of how the grid is adjusted and adapted. Showing sort of full scale details, zoomed in details of the sort of the texture and the tactility of the screen. And then juxtaposing that with movement and really playing with how the stills interact with one another to create an interesting page, but then also how it informs the kind of the narrative of the film. And here you get a real sense of the movement that Cheryl is performing in the video through this sort of juxtaposition and using, you know, simple and very straightforward compositional rules of line and arrangement in order to create this sort of movement through the spread. Cool. Okay, so now I'll try to talk about some of the like typographic principles leveraged and utilized in this book. So, you know, in this video, you can see just very, very straightforward details and information about the book itself. And something that I'm constantly striving for is the largest amount of difference through through as few steps as possible. And that's something that I'm constantly practicing throughout the books. And then it's difference through economy. So here you can see this is the title page of the book, but it's already starting to introduce you to the typographic system as well. And looking at how point size sort of carries over and is sort of static and used over and over throughout the book, and how the table of contents can be, you know, not only a map of the like the content itself, but also how the table of contents already sort of primes you for like the typography that occurs on the inside of the book. So here you can see this table of context, or table of contents, sorry, isn't necessarily arranged in a pure chronological order as it appears through the book, but it's arranged by body of work and type of content within the book. So again, that was like a very conscious decision of separating out the different paintings and then how those things are sort of intersected and woven through the book. An example of the foreword. And you can see a clear sort of connection between point size here and then within the foreword. And then how the foreword structure. So content outside of the essays is represented by one sort of typographic system, and then how that system is then adapted to a different type of content. So here we have an interview between Wade Guyton and Cheryl Donegan, and there's two typefaces used throughout the book, diatype and then a modified version of Swiss BP Serif. And those, like the bodies of work, how they're flipping in and sort of coming in and out of play within different artworks, the typography is sort of flipping in and out through the book in order to sort of create difference. So instead of creating difference through a completely new structure or a change in typographic styling, the typefaces are sort of flipping in and out to sort of create that difference. So here you can see the foreword set in diatype. And then here we see an interview using the same typographic system or typographic structure, but then just flipping and then the serif, BP serif, becoming the prominent typeface. And again, you can see here another example of the interview spread. And something to pay attention to here that we'll see when we get to the essays is how the margins and the pushing and the pulling of type is reused, or structures are reused and repurposed, as opposed to something being created, you know, bespoke for this piece of content. Again, to help the book unify typographically from the front page, from the table of contents, to the end matter. And then this system is again adapted for another text, a very influential text to Cheryl, that was written by architect Rim Koolhaas called Junk Space. And that text is always produced through justified type. But in this context, we wanted to kind of completely break that and then have the text sort of set left and rag right. So shifting the space from the interior of the text into the sort of outer edge of the text block. So again, we see how typographic conventions are reused for the titling of the essays. So a single titling page is used. And then we're introduced to the sort of the essay structure. And again, this essay structure directly correlates to the structures used within the interview. So the interviews represents a sort of a collapsing of different type stylings. And then the foreword and these other texts like Junk Space represent another. So here we see the essays. And then whenever possible, text and image is always shown separate from one another to allow the images to really breathe and to sort of sit next to the text and to sort of tell the story, as opposed to any one of them interrupting each other. So when you're reading this text here, there's a direct correlation to the image placed here. And another thing I'm gonna sort of throw out is this idea of like articulation of the physical aspects of the book. So within this book, I tried to articulate as much as I could in the same way that Cheryl uses as much intentionality as she does within all of her works. So the book thread is intentionally chosen to become black to sort of, again, acknowledge the fact that this is a book and it's sewn together. The headbands are also different. The top headband being a different color than the bottom headband, something that you may have seen through the video. And then again, like I've mentioned earlier, the different paper types used based on the content that's printed on them. And again, here you can see how illustrations are shown on the opposite page, as large as they are within the sort of gridded structure, and then the text here. Cool. And this is another point where content is sort of bumping into one another. So we have the end of an essay bumping into another one of the trifolds mentioned that helps separate the content. And you can see the contrast between the different paper types here. Cool. So yeah, that's a kind of a quick overview of the book design for Cheryl. Something that I will kind of point out that you can see in the video more clearly is again like the difference of paper, because a book is bound pages, and I think it's really important to think about the materiality at the same time that you're thinking about the typographic conventions that you're creating as a designer. And something else that is often unsaid when designers talk about their work is the amount of conversation that goes into the production of these books, and the amount of back and forth between different vendors. And you know, a designer's primary responsibility is a responsibility of that process of manufacturing, really, and the production of physical things, especially when it comes to books. So that's something that you'll see within this next project, which is a smaller book for artist Nate Lowman. So here we can see a drastically different presentation of works. Cheryl's show was within gallery one of the Aspen Art Museum. The next two books, this book and the one after, are galleries two and three. And galleries two and three are joined galleries. So they present particular challenges and opportunities for the artist to show their work within that space. And that's something that I was aware of going in to the design of this book as well. So here you can see it's a salon style hanging of various different works of different scales and different shapes. A trope of Nate Lowman's work that you can kind of see mimicked in the video there is these shaped canvases, these stretched shaped canvases. And the one thing that I wanted to really think about was the translation of experience. So how one is looking at the works within the gallery, how can that same experience be translated into the book space? And so the budget for this book was much smaller than the budget for Cheryl Donegan's book. The Aspen Art Museum, as a point of impetus, typically tries to publish the first book of an artist. So if an artist is having a show at the museum, but they've never had a book published before, that becomes a priority within the publishing schedule. Nate Lowman has had a few books published, artist books and a few catalogs with essays, but we still wanted to take the opportunity to try to do as best as we could to translate his show into the printed form. So here you can see the installation works, how paintings are wrapping corners, different shapes are grouped, how different bodies of work are grouped together and juxtaposed with others. And here we have the front cover and then the back cover. The back cover encapsulates, again, a full-scale kind of detail. So on the back, you get this kind of weird micro shot of the halftone texture from one of Nate's paintings. And then this somewhat sterile cover, again, which is something that was intentionally thought about in terms of crafting this kind of white space, opens up into a different material. So this particular material here is a special mirrored finished C1S, so coated one side paper. And it's something that Nate uses in his studio a lot. You can essentially think about it as a reflective mylar. And we wanted to try to take that material from his studio and try to use it within the book itself. You can see it in the video, a better shot of it sort of here. So you can see this mirrored finished paper with an artwork printed directly over top of it. And again, this is something that would not have been possible without 2 days on press and really dialing it in with the pressmen and with the production coordinators at Dakura who printed all of these books. It took a lot of trial and error, a lot of sourcing, and a lot of time of really sorting out the logistics to incorporate this paper that really only appears within the book a few times. But it's these material choices and this sort of this forethought toward the material and the physical that I think helps take what otherwise could, you know, be a 72 page saddle stitched booklet into something that is altogether different. So you can see it in the video, and you can see a detail of it here. So this is the first spread that you sort of get. This again is an extraction from one of Nate's paintings and is a direct correlation to the painting detail on the back. And when designing this book, we wanted to really privilege the ways in which the artworks were restructured in the book, in the plate section, because the plate section is very different than a typical plate section of any other book. So the typography took a very straightforward and a very clear sort of structure, using a slightly modified weight of Times Now, to give it a little bit more, so the blackness of the text is actually adjusted, and some of the characters were treated slightly different. Again, these are things that that you might not ever notice. But it's something that I like to do when thinking about the typography, is like, what can I do as a designer to sort of make the type, to push the type in a certain direction, to give it a sense of uniqueness that no other book might have. And within the section breaks, so we have a very straightforward section break here, using just one point size. And then that's always coupled with a painting. And Nate's paintings aren't screen printed. You might think, because of the halftone texture, that they are screen printed, but what they are is they're meticulously hand painted. So we removed, so I lifted that black layer directly from the untreated canvas and then dropped that onto the page. So you can almost think about the page being the canvas and then this being the sort of the painted surface. And then here you can see the installation imagery. And the installation imagery here, for very practical reasons, is turned on its side. When working with saddle stitch books, saddle stitching, you essentially stack the pages, and then you fold the entire stack in half and then staple it. And because of that, you often can get images, if you cross the spread, images creeping in. And we wanted to kind of minimize that as much as possible. So the images are turned on their side to make them as large as possible within the grid, and then to show the installation imagery. And then this installation imagery is then remixed. An example of an interview. That installation imagery is remixed and repurposed within the plate section. So this is the sort of the driving aspect of this book. And this is what I mean by translation of experience. So within the gallery space, you see these images and these paintings hanging on the wall, but now the book's gridded structure becomes the gallery wall, and then the paintings are reordered. And I worked directly with the director at the time of the institution, the curator of the show, Heidi Zuckerman, to sort of plan out this sort of rehanging of the show within the book space. So here you can see the paintings, hung within a salon style, but snapped to the book's structure, and then the plate numbers corresponding to the list of illustrations shown here. And again, this was like the kind of the driving idea behind this idea of translation of experience. So offering up snapshots of details of the works, peeking into the artist's studio through the use of this material. And this material is featured on a number of paintings also through the show, this reflective mylar, and then rehanging the show within the book. Cool. So that's Nate Lowman's before and after. The next book that I'm gonna kind of go through is Gabriel Rico's The Discipline of the Cave. The Discipline of the Cave is also shown in galleries 2 and 3. So at the Aspen Art Museum, shows that take place within galleries 1 or galleries 2 and 3 typically are, well, first of all, they're the largest primary gallery spaces within the building. But then also if a show is getting a book, more often than not, almost always, they are placed within galleries 1 or 2 and 3. So here you can see Gabriel Rico's show, very different, almost acknowledging the sort of gallery as an infinite space, and creating these landscapes that play with your sort of perceptions of reality, sort of hearkening back to this idea or the sort of visuals that you might see in the background art of, say, like the Looney Tunes, but then playing with the choice of material and how the artworks are made to really sort of put a slippage between sort of like the natural or reality and then, you know, a crafted space. And outside of like the translation of material, something that's important is also like the duality between the two galleries. So galleries 2 and 3 are separated and connected. And within the second gallery, so again, here we can see this is gallery 2. We have these clay, meticulously crafted objects that sort of play with your idea of craft, of simplicity. So these porcelain and ceramic pieces. Here's some details of some of the artworks and how they're sort of scattered throughout the space. So these meticulously crafted and arranged objects within gallery 2 are juxtaposed with the artworks within gallery 3. And these artworks were like a lot of the art that happens to come to the Aspen Art Museum is inspired by the artists' initial site visits and their sort of explorations of Aspen and Colorado as a whole. So we have, so Gallery 3 is a different body of works inspired by Gabriel Rico's time within Aspen Art Museum and using sort of, again, creating a different sort of space, you know, one space being unnatural and almost cartoonish, and then another space becoming a sort of surreal depiction or a slightly differing depiction of what reality is in the mountains of Colorado. So these animals, the taxidermy here, like locally and sustainably sourced, but each species is local to Colorado. And specifically the counties surrounding the Aspen Art Museum. Cool. So these ideas of craft are craft and material is something that I wanted to translate directly to the book. And this idea of craft and structure and material influenced everything from the typeface chosen to the structure of the book, this idea of duality, and the fact that the book is bilingual. So this book is published, all of the texts are published in English and Spanish, acknowledging Gabriel Rico's heritage, as well as the heritage of the indigenous communities around Colorado and the languages spoken. So again, trying to open up the conversation and really boosting ideas of participation within the artist, within the space at the museum, but then within the catalog as well. And something to pay attention to here is this particular paper, which on one side is gold leafed. It's a paper made by the paper manufacturer Takeo, based in Japan. And this paper represents this idea of duality between the two galleries. So the sort of meticulously crafted on one side, so the gold leafed side of the paper, and then on the other side, the raw natural craft brown aspect of the paper. And that gold is used throughout pieces featured within gallery 2 and Gabrielle's work. And then the typeface here that really sort of pushes the typography is a serif called Stanley that's somewhat modeled off of Times New Roman, but something that you get to see at these really large sizes is like the angular crafting of the serif. So I knew that I wanted to use the typeface as big as possible to show off those angular serifs and again point to this idea of sort of manufacturing and crafting that is, you know, that resonates within Gabriel Rico's work. And like the two galleries are sort of separated by a doorway, the book is organized with Spanish represented on the left-hand page, and then English being represented on the right-hand page. So here you can see the table of contents as it is in both English and Spanish. And wherever possible, this special Takeo paper is used to separate the English and the Spanish. So you're almost always seeing the section breaks in only one language. And that paper, whether or not it's the gold face or the natural crafted face, is used throughout the book. So again, a book of 88 pages, but you know, not just thinking about you know, page length as a primer for the book's construction, or you know, the book's importance, but trying to think about it materially. So here you can see how that paper sort of shifts between the English and the Spanish translation. And the structure here is completely lifted from the table of contents. So the table of contents is rippling throughout the book. And you'll see that the section break for the installation views lands here. So again, repurposing and reusing a structure set at the beginning of the book, further within the book, similar to the ideas of structure within Cheryl Donegan's catalog. And you can see here, again, going down the table of contents. So this is a section break for one of the essays within the essay section. And then we have the bilingual essays featured here. Again, very sort of straightforward typesetting. Using Stanley. And here you have the installation views, Spanish, special division paper, and then the English. So you can see the gold and then the craft. Again, this duality between the two different galleries and the works that they represent. Some details, again, showing you know, the fact that this gold isn't arbitrary. So looking at the artworks and then sort of using my knowledge of paper, you know, which can't be understated, right? Like, this book wouldn't have been possible without, you know, the knowledge of me knowing that this material sort of exists. So constantly investing yourself in educating yourself on the different types of materials that exist out there, as opposed to just taking something at face value, you know, that a book can only have one sort of paper, or, you know, a book can't use this type of material because it's never been used in any other books I've seen before. And then, like the paper is being used to show the section breaks, the paper again makes another appearance. And because this book is thread sewn, which again is like another, ode to the sort of the craftsmanship. So it's sewn with three hole punches, again, as opposed to machine Smith sewn, like the other books. It has to be organized in such a way that the paper is going to land in the right spot, because like Nate Lowman's book, everything is stacked and folded and then stitched. So a lot of forethought is placed in the organization of content in order to sort of push the idea forward. So again, and you're working with the inherent structures of a physical object of the book. And this paper is used to separate and show the introduction of a new gallery. So walking into the new gallery, this is the view that you're seeing. And using the paper, again, to sort of make that transition period a little bit more prominent. Cool. And okay, great. Doing good on time. So the last book I'm gonna talk about, I'll have to move somewhat quickly through it, is Margaret Kilgallen's That's Where the Beauty Is. And this show, like Cheryl's show, took place in Gallery One. And I want to talk about ideas of translation of process and then life. And then also something that's very important to Margaret's contribution and bodies of work, which is like the equality of work, and this idea that everything that the artist is doing and touching, you know, isn't distinguished from any other sort of body of work, right? Like the paintings or drawings aren't more important than, say, the diary or the sketchbook. There's like a real sort of like innocence and understanding of practice within Margaret's work. And that's something that we tried to capture within the book itself. And another thing worth noting is that outside of this book, there's a popular and sold out and now very expensive catalog of her works that was published by the Red Cat Gallery, if I remember correctly, in Cal Arts. So we went in knowing that there was a demand and there was an accessibility issue for Margaret's work to the general population. And we wanted to take this opportunity, one, as an impetus for the show itself, but also take this opportunity to try to pack as much content and as much new content within this book as possible. So that's something that you'll see throughout the different sections. And taking cues from Margaret's life, outside of being an artist, she worked at the San Francisco Public Library. And one of her primary responsibilities within the San Francisco Public Library was the repair of books. So, you know, that presents like a very interesting sort of proposition as a book designer. So, you know, how can one create a book that sort of hints at itself almost kind of like falling apart without sort of, you know, while playing within very sort of recognized book construction ideas. So this book is produced with like an open lay flat cover, hardcover, and an exposed spine. So that's something you can see here is the cover of the book completely laying flat, and then the spine and the threading and the stacking of the individual signatures is exposed. And the first thing that you're seeing when you open the book is the table of contents, as well as an introductory note from the curator here. Then you can see the thread being articulated. So not using just standard white thread, but, you know, using red thread to signal the fact that this is a sewn book, and then also playing into the total system of the book as a whole. And then the special sort of signature wrap here is just a standard craft paper. And one of the bodies of work that Margaret produced that kind of goes unseen often is the works that she would make out of found materials from the street. So taking found materials, raw materials like raw plywood, raw cardboard, and then making works on them and then putting them back into that original context. So we wanted to sort of point to that using these rawer materials, so a raw craft paper being used here. And then in this, you can kind of see the sort of exposed spine happening that I mentioned earlier. And then an example of illustrations within an essay. So we have the essay section break, an example of illustrations within that essay, and then an example of the text page here. And the typography of this book was like intentionally pointed toward representing this like idea of something that's more approachable or more recognizable in terms of like novel paperback typography. So paying attention to like those proportions of column width and even the book's scale, pointing back to that as well. So you can see how the craft paper is used throughout the book here within this video. And then the printed chronology. So to separate the chronology from a typical text, I'm using a different typeface or a different type size, and then it's being printed all in red And this choice of red printing echoed the gallery guide that lived within within the museum. So the typographic conventions oftentimes through all of these books is echoed within the gallery guide. So connecting the viewer, the patron experience through that ephemera to the catalog itself. And then here you can see details of one of the works. Main drag, which is a large installation within the Aspen Art Museum. You get details here. And then here we see a typical plate, a plate spread from the book. And the show was hung in such a way that you can see here that clusters of artworks were grouped together. And these were done in collaboration with the curator and then the estate. And the primary objective or the primary driving point was to sort of recreate the walls within the book space. So here, the artworks are shown just as they are hung on the wall, as large as possible within the book's format, creating a sort of one-to-one relationship. Actually, you can see it right here. So you can see this this cluster of artworks featured and how it's featured in the book, creating as much of a translation of experience as possible from the gallery space to the book form. So as well as our exhibition, looking at past exhibitions was also important. And often these past exhibitions took place in very ephemeral circumstances, like in parking garages. So installing works within parking garages that have then since been torn down, and then offering people, you know, the sort of the documentation of that within this book, and trying to encapsulate as much of her practice as possible. So we have installation views, we have essays, we have paintings, and then in addition to the paintings, we wanted to try to show as much ephemera as possible, whether that's actual sort of pieces and sort of remnants of works that Margaret produced in her sketchbooks, or stickers, artist books and zines, and then showing these, this ephemera in the same way that we would show the artworks, right? Like treating everything equally to sort of reflect the artist's practice and the way of working. Because for Margaret, a zine or an artist book was no different than a large scale installation within a parking garage. So there's a collapse of importance, right? Everything is treated equally within the book. And again, it goes back to, you know, repurposing as opposed to creating something new within the book structure. And then something that is largely missing from Red Cat's catalog is that of photography. And we really wanted to show what Margaret's life was like. So showing the life of the artist and, you know, everything happening around the artworks. So there's a photography section within this book featuring primarily photographs by Ed Templeton and Deanna Templeton. You could see the craft paper sort of coming back in. This being the first spread of the photography section. And then another example. So showing, Margaret, you know, in her sort of everyday life, and then how at the same way the artworks were part of that life. Yeah, that's it.
So thank you, David. That was very, I really enjoyed it, and it was really great to see you talk about the details and all the thought processes that went into your design work. I don't know if there's anyone has questions from anybody who's in the audience. I guess the easiest way to do it is, maybe put your hand up if there are questions, if there's a lot, or if there's not, just I guess jump in and ask while you've got David here.
Yeah, please ask questions. But also no pressure. Questions.
This is what it's like in my classroom. There's like you're waiting for that question and it just never
Yeah.
seems to.
Well, I went through the last three books, and while the talk was going, I had my website sort of going through every project on my website. So, if there's something that caught your eye from that you also want to ask about,
Well,
I can try to sort of talk about, or if there's something about the books that I just, because I went through the last three books rather quickly.
actually, Phil, we have one. Philippe has asked wants to ask a question.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Hey, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great. Awesome. Hey, thank you so much for this. Really appreciate the talk as well. I really want to come back with a term that you mentioned a few times, the word translate or reflect, like a kind of reflection from the artist. So have you ever have an experience between or a friction between translate and also appropriate? So just for context, the goal is to respect the body of work for the artist and showcase that in a specific way in the book. But
Yeah.
as a designer, and also you are the designer of that book, so have you ever have a close line between appropriation of the of, from the artist of her
Sure.
or his work? So can you explain that a little bit?
Yeah, so that's actually a really good question, and I'll actually use the Margaret Kilgallen's so Margaret Kilgallen's book was the only book that I've worked on so far out of all of the books. These included, in which the artist was deceased. And so the estate was essentially operating as the artist would. And not to dive so deep into the politics and the relationships between institutions and estates and what that means. But I will say that we wanted to make Margaret Kilgallen's book, especially this book, as different and all-encompassing as possible, compared to the book that was produced and published by the Red Cat Gallery. So I actually had to completely redesign Margaret Kilgallen's book after all approvals have been made, like three quarters away through the entire process. So something else that I meant to touch on at the very beginning that I didn't is that these books are produced over schedules, like going from 6 months to one book that I'm working on that has been in the works for almost 2 years. So you're working on these. So the production of these books is a very slow endeavor, and oftentimes there's a lot of conversation, a lot of back and forth, and then at times like a lot of red tape. So we had a design that was approved and had been seen by many members of the estate. It was signed off on, but then something that it's part of the conversation is that anytime that you show something, it's an opportunity for criticism. And then the estate felt like the book didn't represent the sort of, in some ways, it didn't mimic her typography as closely as they thought it should. That was like an intentional decision on my part, was to try not to mimic her typographic sentiments through the book's design, because the Red Cat book, I think, in my personal opinion, did a very poor job at that. That was like a main driving force of that book, and I think that sort of direct mimicry does injustice to the artist's work. So we had to kind of go back to the drawing board, or I had to go back to the drawing board and sort of reassess the situation. And we came up with a different typographic solution that involved using a completely redrawn version of Jansen to sort of give it a little bit more of that humanistic feel. So that's a case in which I was preemptively fighting against this notion of appropriation, and then having to sort of circle back at the end of the situation to kind of meet people and meet the sort of estate in the middle and come up with like an interesting solution that we all could sort of be happy with, as well as like not just, you know, sort of mimicking the artist. If that sort of answers your question.
This is the book that you're referring to, the Kilgallen, yep. The original, or for whatever, the one that the Red Cat put out, and it came out in this cover, and this is the first edition, second edition's beige. This is the, I don't know if this shows up, but that's the type kind of,
yes,
it's kind of a vernacular
typography
that you can kind of see. And then I don't, you didn't really have a great photo, but this is that.
Yes, there's the exposed spine.
Yeah, lay flat binding, and then it's glued
down
on one
side. Can you hold those books up next to each other? So they should be roughly the exact same size. Yep.
They're close.
Yeah. So that was something, that was like another intentional thing, is like if they were sitting next to each other, they would sort of feel at home, but then they would be different. And the difference was like even more stark before the redesign. But you can see, yeah, the sort of difference between the vernacular type that they used and then the more bookish type. So I tried to lean more toward the bookish aspect as opposed to the vernacular in the redesign of that book. Yeah.
David, there's a few questions in the chat. Sam, I'm thinking this is Samantha. What type of work did you make at Cranbrook, and how did that work translate to the books you're making now?
Yeah, so we're kind of getting to that point. So at Cranbrook, my first year at Cranbrook, and then the second year in which I met David, the works being produced are like diametrically opposed. You know, I could talk about this entire experience for 6 hours at least, but
don't go there.
I realized within my second year at Cranbrook that I really wanted to become a book designer. I really wanted to work with the book format as like a primary vehicle for communicating my work, and then the work I wanted to do as a designer once I left. So I started making books, and oftentimes like using my own content. So you can see here, this is a book I made in collaboration in that video of my site with a friend, Clint, of photographs. So I started generating content or repurposing content that I found interesting, and tried to find different connections to sort of, you know, give myself excuses to make books, and to you know, instead of communicating my ideas through a poster or some other form of design, how can I communicate that idea or that content that I was either reading or writing or making myself through artworks? How can I communicate that within the book form? How could I make a poster and then translate that into the book form? So I really experimented with the book as like a constant within my second year at Cranbrook, and even beyond.
And so another question from Alex. You mentioned that it's important to invest in yourself on materials. Do you have any recommendations on this? I myself would like to experiment with different materials, but don't know where to start or how to, especially because of COVID.
Yeah, so something that my time at Urban really opened my eyes to was the potential of a swatch book. And so, you know, just like immersing yourself within theoretical concepts can help shift your practice in the ways in which you design, immersing yourself within swatch books, for better or worse, will help you sort of, will help you know like what is possible, and then what you can then push within the production process in collaboration with printers or other vendors. So oftentimes, you know, these companies who create this paper whether it's conventional paper or special paper, the mills, they want you to use their paper as a designer, and they're often, they will send you swatch books for free. So, you know, just if you find a book that you like, flip to the colophon. If the designer is doing the responsible thing, they'll put the types of papers that they're using, and they'll put the typefaces that they're using, and then track down, just try to track down those materials. The same thing goes for if you see a material, you know, within the world that you think could be interesting within a book or within some other project. You know, it doesn't have to be a book, it could be a poster, or any other form of design. But you haven't seen it before, like, don't let that be a limitation or stop you. You know, like, contact the person that you're collaborating with or try to make it happen. Because the worst thing that a printer can say, and oftentimes they don't even say this, is no. And there's so many different things that I've done through the collaboration of a willing printer. So yeah, just try to expose yourself to as many different things as possible. And if you see something that you like, within another book, you know, try to inform yourself about things around it.
Question from Daniela. How do you decide on the size of a book, or is that already determined prior?
Yeah, so there's multiple ways in which this conversation comes about. So one is economy. You know, books are printed on larger sheets of paper that are then folded down into what are called signatures. And you can either choose to be economical with that constraint based on the press size and the paper size. So one choice is economy. Another idea is connotation. So what kind of book do you want this book to sit next to or to sort of feel when someone is flipping through it? I just finished working on a book for Rashid Johnson, another artist that was exhibited at the Aspen Art Museum. And Rashid's books, the books produced for and published for Rashid up to that point had been larger or smaller gallery publications that are fairly small, fairly slim. He's never really had a book, a hardcover book that connotated this idea of catalog resume. So something that you would associate with like with modernist painters, like a catalog resume of Jasper John's monoprints. So we wanted to really connote that, and those books tend to be like a larger size. So we tried to produce the largest book within economical means of a 16 or 8 page signature with the printer Dakura. And the largest signature that we printed with that book is 16 pages. There are other presses around Europe, printers in Italy that can produce 32 page signatures. But another thing to also think about as a book designer is the larger the signature size, the sort of the more chance you're playing with in terms of like halftone processing and color alignment. So that's another thing to think about as well. But really, economy and then connotation are the driving factors when I'm thinking about scale and size of a book.
You might want to mention how the size in terms of folding, again, just because we got a lot of students, you might just explain how the folding affects the size for the signature.
Yeah, so different signature, like, are you talking about like the configurations and the ways in which the paper is folded?
Well, just in terms of the more you fold it, like if you're going to get a 32 page signature, this obviously the size is going to get smaller as you go.
Yeah. So you're thinking about like a larger sheet, and you know, if this talk was about book production, we could talk, you know, about this ad nauseum, but you have a larger sheet and it's folded, and every time you fold that sheet, it's going to get smaller, but also there's a chance, and the, you know, when I say a chance of slippage, the slippage is millimeters or fractions of millimeters, but when it comes to halftoning across like CMYK processing in terms of color production, these things matter. So a 32 page signature is going to get folded more than a 16 page signature for a given size of the book. And because of the number of folds, the possibility of error and alignment also compounds with every fold. So oftentimes I try to work with eight to 16 page signatures at most, and certain printers like Decura will only go up to that that size as well, because of, you know, the rigor that they have in terms of like their production of art books.
They're located in Belgium, yeah.
Yeah, they're located in Bruges, Belgium. So all of the books that I talked about today were printed by Decura. And again, I mentioned it before, but it can't go understated, is that the production of these books is just as much, you know, me as a designer coming up with like conceptual and typographic solutions, but it's like depending on the collaboration and conversation with printers and pressmen and production managers there in order to really sort of get the most out of it. So the special Mylar paper I mentioned in Nate Lohman's book, I spent two days on press getting the color and the clarity as best as possible. And we eventually actually had to shut down half of the press and run it in using just like half of the press at a time. Whereas like a piece of paper will print both sides at once. That was causing too much sort of buildup on the sheet because the Mylar was picking up almost everything as it ran through the press. So really sort of paying attention to those things and like having a printer who's willing to go the extra mile to allow something like Mylar paper to be incorporated into a book.
I got a question from Lucy. How do you determine whether a book should be a direct recreation or documentation of an exhibition, or a distinct experience which exists separate from the exhibition? Is that due to negotiation with the curator or artist?
Yeah, so a lot of the content, a lot of like the conversations around content and the presentation of the artworks is you know, between the designer, the editor. The editor is like another important factor within this process. So you have the designer, the editor, the curator, and then surprisingly, a few, you know, Cheryl, for instance, Cheryl and Gabriel Rico, they were very passive participants. You know, they offered points of criticism, but they really left us to sort of do what we thought was best within, first of all, within the show itself, but then also within the book. So they were, you know, they were along for the ride, but they weren't a sort of point of friction, and they were really open to each of us, the curator, the designer, and the editor, to sort of do what we thought was best. And the video section of Cheryl's book is 120 pages, and me and the co-curator spent days with Cheryl's entire video works, going through the high-res video and making those selections and making those screenshots. And we wouldn't have been able to do that without the trust of the artist. Same thing goes for Gabriel Rico. He was really open to suggestion. And at first we had planned for a slightly more robust catalog for him, but given the works and the content, we really wanted to sort of lean it more toward this like three hole sewn book. And, you know, this was Gabriel Rigo's first book. And, you know, if I was an artist, my snap reaction would be to have the biggest book, the flashiest book as possible. But he was really open to this, like this direction that took his work and really leveraged like ideas of craft. So, those types of ideas come through through conversation.
But do you? I'm going to just press that issue though. Do you, when you're working, I mean, how do you broach the subject of I'm going to make, like, because artists, I'm assuming, don't really understand when you talk about I'm going to make your book an object or I'm going to make it an experience.
Yeah.
Whereas they understand if you say I'm going to make it a documentation of the exhibition.
Yeah. So, so another thing that's kind of missing from this talk. So, outside of like the hundreds of emails that go into like making a book, are the production decks and the presentations that that I made to help communicate this idea. Because even myself as a designer, the closest thing that you get to seeing this book before it arrives on your doorstep is a series of dummies and then occasionally wet proofs. At least that's the case. And a wet proof is a color proof of a flat sheet off the press that shows imagery. So it's like a color proofing tactic. So what you have to do is you have conversation with Cheryl's book in particular. I showed her the swatches. You know, you assemble your paper swatches, the cover material. We were in the gallery. I showed her this cover material. We looked at the painting. It made sense from the very beginning. And you try to sort of create as holistic a picture as possible without having the actual book in front of you. And that's what those hundreds of emails are with printers, is making sure that your vision is aligning with reality. So having this conversation, building presentation decks, and then talking them through the ideas and showing the fact that this isn't just going to be a plate book, like we are translating your different bodies of work, and this is how we're gonna do it. Because you can have a book that is just, you know, plates printed on a matte paper with like an essay at the front and an essay at the back, and that's fine. There are galleries and institutions that produce books like that ad nauseum and constantly, but I think it was understood that the Aspen Art Museum approaches design, and that's what led me to apply to the Aspen Art Museum at the first place, is that they approach design from a more nuanced and elevated sense. And I think the artists also understood that coming in. And we show them other books that we've made and how their show is going to translate. So a big point of reference for the Cheryl Donegan book was a book produced for the artist Alan Shields, designed by Michael Aberman. So showing Cheryl that, you know, this is what we did for Alan, and this is what we're going to do for you, and this is what it's going to look like. And then having the artist trust you, because I think trust and empathy within a client or collaborator is one of the most important things to leading to make great work.
Question from Alex again. Actually, you know what? I'm going to ask the second one because you might have to take off. So where do you usually find your printers?
Yeah. So from the very beginning, it's always been Dakura, just because of their commitment and their commitment and their rigor and like the quality of the works that they produce. They really cut out a market for themselves in producing like high quality art books. And as actually 2 months within, so all the books that Aspen Art Museum has produced for like the last, I don't know, 8 years, five to 8 years, have been produced and printed by Dakura. So we've developed like a really close knit relationship that's transcended designers that have like moved through the institution. And at the time, the vice president of relations, he actually would visit Aspen Art Museum once to twice a year. So 3 months into my time at the Aspen Art Museum, Michael came to visit, and we really got to sort of talk with each other and really got to actually talk face to face about Cheryl's book, because at the time, that book really kicked off right when I started there. Was really thrown in head first, but I was able to form like a deep connection and realize that, you know, I knew from looking at other art books that Dakura had a commitment to it, but then when you get to speak with a representative and someone, you get a better sense that, you know, that they know what they're doing and they respect and they want to sort of make something happen. You know, printers, there are printers who can have a press, and you know, as long as the press is running, they're making money. Anything that keeps that press from moving on to the next project, you know, frankly, is hurting their bottom line. But Dakura, you know, they really crafted a space to allow designers and artists to come in and really push that process. And it not just be one of economy, but becomes one of craft. And I can't, you know, I can't speak any more highly of Dakura because of this, because there aren't very many printers out there. None in the US that I know of that approach, you know, art book printing the same way, or printing in general.
And another one from Alex. So Alex says, I found that and liked the project CSDW1 Floral on your website. Do you mind talking about that?
Yeah, so that was like a project that I did with a friend and collaborator, Clint, who I hope is still listening. Yeah, and that was really just an exercise in like us producing and, you know, creating our own excuse to make things. Like, as a designer and as a creative, something that was imbued in me at Cranbrook was like the idea that my hands can't stop moving. So I'm constantly kind of making and repurposing and recycling content. And that project came, you know, from a very simple photo shoot of objects that I made from found materials. So from a photo shoot, out of sculptures that I made of found material, was then translated into a sort of larger book initiative in which I collaborated with my friend Clint. And he approached another physical object in a very similar way. So taking a physical object and then reconceptualizing that within a different context. And that's something that I'm constantly doing through like my own self-initiated work, is taking content from one platform or from like one mode or medium, and then finding ways of translating that into something else. You know, whether it's experimentation or to sort of to push the narrative of that work into something different. So yeah.
Okay, it's 20 minutes to 8, and I'm sure you're a little bit tired there. So I'd just like to say thank you and wrap up. Again, thank you for putting together this presentation and speaking to everyone. Cool. And thank you all for attending. Very much appreciated your participation. So thank you very much, David.
Cool, thanks.